California has taken a serious step toward universal health coverage. The Senate Health Committee voted earlier this week to approve the Healthy California Act. Tonight on Elected Spotlight, we'll talk with Assemblymember Mark Stone, a co-author of this bill, and learn the possibilities it holds for Californians. We'll also learn about his other bills, bills to protect our coastline. Stay with us. Well, welcome. Thanks for coming in this evening.
Thank you. Very happy to be here.
Well, before we talk about the health of our people, let's talk about the health of our environment. You've done our coastline has really taken some hits this winter, and you have a bill that could help protect that coastline. Tell us a little bit about your idea and how it would work.
It's one of the first bills that's addressing adaptation needs to build a resilient California. We've talked a lot about adapting to climate changes, sea level rises, changes in weather patterns, but we've done really very little about it. And right now, there are a number of properties across the state who have sought emergency permits for seawalls, but have never come back, as is a part of their emergency permit, to clean up and get address the situation in a permanent way. So what the bill does is it tries to protect coastal access and protect our coastal resources by giving the Coastal Commission some additional administrative authority to go to those property owners and get them to come back and seek a permit with appropriate permit conditions make the situation a little bit more appropriate with respect to the coast so that we don't have unneeded seawalls, revetments, and other structure that will exacerbate the coastal access, exacerbate erosion, and have other harmful effects.
Now, I've seen that you have written that seawalls kind of do have a harmful effect on our ecosystem. Could you talk a little bit about what you're concerned with there?
Yes. California's coast is very fragile, and it's been eroding since it was formed, and that it will continue to erode. And yet we've built a lot of private structures, public structures, roads, sewer lift stations, you name it, along the coast. And as the seas rise, the initial inclination is to want to armor that coast, put a wall up, concrete or
those big walls. See on Highway 17.
Yes, those kinds of walls or along East Cliff Drive, there are some significant seawalls there to protect. But once you harden one spot of the coast, it exacerbates erosion in other parts of the coast. It sends that wave energy further down. And so we may be protecting parts of the coast, and we may be putting other parts at risk, at further risk. But also, if you harden as the seas rise, then and you harden a bluff, for example, and that bluff can't retreat in the way it's intended to retreat, then as the sea rises, it drowns the beach, and we no longer have a beach. Uh-huh. So if we want to have beaches in California, if we want to have access along the 1,100 miles of coast, we have to be very careful what we're willing to armor or not armor. And that's the conversation the Coastal Commission needs to have in a much more robust way. And we have to clean up a lot of emergency permits and unpermitted structures along the coast in order to ensure that we're providing access and addressing the changes to our coastlines.
So does this bill put a little more oversight on the big picture, the long game for the coast?
It does. And the legislature gave the Commission Administrative Penalty Authority a few years ago over access issues. And what this bill does is it extends that administrative penalty authority over illegal or no longer permitted or unpermitted coastal structures. And it defines better what those coastal structures are and how that works. The Commission, it uses language pretty much the same as what the Commission's been utilizing over the last couple of decades, but it really wasn't written down anywhere. There was no formal policy. So in a way, it's instruction of the Commission, but it's a lot clearer of what the statutory framework would be if somebody does want to come and ask for a permit for a seawall.
So at risk, just as at risk as our coastline is the actual ocean itself, and one of the biggest threats is plastic litter, marine litter. Can you talk a little bit about the danger of that?
That we keep putting more and more plastic into our oceans. And I know in our area, most of us have done coastal cleanups and find a lot of plastic items around. We had a bill a couple of years ago successfully addressing microplastics, microbeads that are in soaps and cosmetics and things. And the industry is moving away from those. But we also have the third or the fifth, depending on who's counting, most numerous item are bottle caps. We do a good job collecting bottles back into the recycling system, but we don't do a good job of bottle caps. So I have a bill this year that would leash the lid, if you will, leash the lid, attach the bottle cap to the bottle so that when the bottle goes back into recycling, the lid is much more likely to come with it instead of being left out on the beach or on a river or in parks where they tend to be. And plastic is very detrimental to sea life.
I know, there's a picture on your press release about this of a bird that has eaten just a lot of plastic. The bird is full of plastic.
Everywhere that the scientists have gone to look at effects of plastic, and they find fish and they find birds, and any dead ones they find or fish that they catch and they cut open, they all have plastic on their insides. And at some point, the fish or the bird will eat enough plastic that they feel full and that they can't take in any more actual food, and they will starve. So the plastic is so proliferate across the entire ocean that it's a major problem, and there's really no practical way to clean it up. What we have to do is stop the inputs into the ocean by changing our habits, not using single-use plastics, increasing recycling efforts, and for the plastic that is out there in the economy, getting it back into the recycling stream.
Well, good luck with that.
Thank you.
That sounds like a good thing to be doing.
Yeah. Now,
you probably face some challenge from the beverage industry. Have you thought
a
about
a lot of challenge with the beverage industry? And I've been talking to them quite a bit. And in fact, had a little bit of trouble in the Natural Resources Committee, where I sit on that committee, and I was working with the new chair, who was not quite comfortable with this. It's the committee that this bill should have flown through, but we had a little bit of challenge. And I'm going to continue to work with the plastics industry. I think they're becoming, they realize that they need to be a part of the solution, and I believe are working on technologies that would facilitate this. And we may need to talk about carbonated versus non-carbonated like water bottles, mm-hmm. because the fill technology and the processes they use to bottle are a little bit different. And that's fine. I want to put us on a timeline to getting lids back into the recycling stream instead of out in the environment. And they know they need to be talking, and we're talking. They're not happy, but we're talking.
Well, in the meantime, we can all put the lids back on our bottles.
Put the lids back on the bottles, or put the lid itself, even if it's off the bottle, back in the recycling bin. Yeah.
And they're recyclable, right?
They are recyclable. Lids. Absolutely recyclable.
Okay. All right. Well, now let's move on to the people.
Okay.
So you must be very happy that the Healthy California bill made it through the committee this week.
I am. I wasn't surprised. It faces a big hurdle in the Senate Appropriations Committee because it can be expensive depending on how it's divided up. And the notion for this, we've been talking about single payer for a long time, and California is probably a pretty good environment to be able to have this conversation. Because of the size of the market and the number of people who need to be covered. Of course, with the Affordable Care Act, until early November, we were still expecting the federal government to be a partner in how we deliver health care. Mm-hmm. They're not such a willing partner anymore, mm-hmm. although I think they're having a little trouble repealing or replacing or figuring out what to do with health care, and that gives us a bit of a pause. We're using that pause to really look hard at health care policy in California, how we could move more towards single payer and get some control over that market and get health care out to everyone in an affordable way. But that means the state would need to step up, which we do in a large part anyway, and the single payer would consolidate a lot of it and put the state in a much better situation to negotiate with the insurance companies, to negotiate what that market is, and we would, I think, be able to provide quality health care for a much better price to the individuals who are paying those health care rates.
Well, there are some studies that say that if this happened, that Californians would save something like $344 billion over 10 years.
Yes. Yeah, the individuals would save. The state, it would cost state general fund. That's the balance we need to strike. But that's really worth it if we could start to whittle down this just obscene amount that we seem to be increasing every year having to pay out to the insurance companies for health coverage. When we did the Affordable Care Act, the part that was not done was either to create a public option or to do insurance reform in the healthcare insurance industry. And until we have a handle on the way rates are structured, then we really don't have the leverage to know what healthcare should cost. Having a public option, having single payer, having the state having leverage in that area will really give us a much better sense or a better ability to influence the rate structure.
So right now, California gets, I don't know, $261 billion, I think, from the federal government
right. That
goes to Medicare and Medi-Cal and CHIP and mm-hmm. And the Affordable Health Care Act. And so if that money kept coming, if you were able to get the government to channel that here, that would cover a big part of this
it would.
Pie, but there would still be, I guess, what I'm reading is all the people that have insurance through their employers, they would need to be insured, and that would be maybe a billion plus.
Depends on how we structure,
mm-hmm. Yeah.
And that's really the question then, how we structure this and whether we just do full-on single payer or we build some tiers. That's the conversation we need to have. And even the benefit, even if we don't take on yet those who have private insurance, the fact that there's public insurance out there would really shine a light on the rate setting and I think would bring the current health insurance providers a little more rationality into their decisions, and I would expect us to see lower prices, individual prices overall.
So this could be a stepwise process. You don't have to dive right into universal health care.
It could be. It has a long political journey yet to go through the Senate appropriations, Senate floor, and then over to the Assembly, and I know that the authors are talking with the governor's office about it and trying to set all this up. So it may look very different by the time it comes over to the Assembly, but the important thing is we're having a very serious conversation about healthcare and the future of healthcare in California and the state's role.
Well, let's talk a little bit about, say this worked out, how would it be structured? So everybody would get a health card, and if they got sick, what would happen? What would be the mechanism?
Yeah, the state would be, I mean, if in its full form, if this happened, the state would really be the insurer, if you will. They would be the one that would contract with the different providers, and we would all have available, instead of the myriad of companies to go to, we would have various options, but under an umbrella that was negotiated with the economic power of the state and 380 million customers.
Yeah, that's a lot of people. And that was the problem for Vermont, when they really tried hard, but they didn't have enough people.
They don't, and we do. And the other benefit to this is how goes California often goes the rest of the country. If we can show what works and that it works, then I think we can change the landscape for healthcare across the nation.
So the governor hasn't seemed very positive. Do you have a plan or ideas of how to make this seem more palatable to him?
He's always very cautious at the beginning of a process, and I think we need to show we can move the bill before he's going to engage. This has been true in any number of scenarios. We just passed the transportation package, which was very important to him, but he took a sideline role until he could see where the legislature was going to go with this. And once we had solidified between the two houses, he stepped in and really made the deal happen. So I don't think we're going to get him to the table unless we can show that we can that we have a serious chance of moving this bill, and that we're likely to put it on his desk. Then he'll engage, because he'll want it to be successful. However we do healthcare, he'll want it to be successful.
Yeah, I'm sure. Yeah. I think he wants the state to be successful for sure.
He definitely does.
Well, let me go back a couple of seconds here to our more of how this would work. So if you have this health care, can you pick your own doctor, or do you have to get a new doctor, a different doctor?
Well, the details have yet to be worked out, but I think we've learned from dealing with health care, kind of watching what's happened across the country and here in California, the notion is, my notion would be, you need to be able to pick your own doctor. We wouldn't have so many different plans and so many different companies that we would have isolated doctor groups in different areas. All of them would be available. And so it would be very important that we be able to pick our doctor, that we have the individuals. The hallmark of single payer is that for the individuals, there's as much flexibility as possible. That would be a success.
That would be. Yeah, that would make a lot of people happy to be able to pick their doctor.
Yeah,
so
absolutely.
What's covered under this insurance? I mean, the medical and dental and vision?
Right now it's medical. And part of my frustration with the whole system that we've done historically is we don't do whole person insurance. It used to be that eyeglasses, for example, weren't even covered. You know, dental was a bit of an offshoot. And it's a little silly if you think about it, that we need to have dental and we need to have eye care and mental health as well as physical health all contained in a broader scope, so that whatever the issue is that somebody has, that it can be addressed in a seamless manner. That, again, would be the ideal. But we have a lot of history with a bit of a fractured system, and I'm not quite sure how we're going to rationalize all of that, but it would definitely need to be a part of it. And again, there's not a lot of detail to answer these questions mm-hmm. yet. We need to look at, I think as we look at the numbers, the dollars that this might cost is when we're going to be looking at options, restrictions, kind of changes in that sense.
Well, as we get back around to the money for this, is there an idea that there might be deductibles for some people, or a sliding scale, or would it be funded by taxes?
It would be, well, if anything that's funded out of the general fund, if the state's putting money on the table, that is funded out of taxes. There's no notion of raising taxes at this point. We want to see if we can fit this within what kind of the state's framework for healthcare. And then as far as deductibles and things go, I imagine there would be. Those details are not a part of this plan just yet. But I imagine there would be, because I think we all need to have a little bit of skin in the game and some responsibility, even if the deductibles are lower. Mm-hmm. And maybe deductibles scale based a little bit on income levels. I mean, those are the conversations that we need mm-hmm. to have as part of the cost conversation, because all of that weighs into how that insurance is really structured.
So some of that work might already have been done, figuring out what people can afford and how much actually the insurance should or could cost by going through the Affordable Care Act.
There's some of that, but we are missing some big pieces in how some of these rates are structured. There was a ballot initiative a couple of years ago that would have given the state insurance commissioner, who's an elected official, authority over rate setting for the healthcare industry. That's the only insurance industry that the insurance commissioner has no authority over. He can go in for, you know, auto, home, any other insurance, and get information about to keep control over runaway rate setting. But the health insurance industry was very successful in beating that ballot measure back. So we have no insight into how they set healthcare rates. Mm-hmm. Yeah, and which is why either a public option or going this way, that will give us the ability, because it would be the single payer who is establishing and setting the rates.
And as you'd have most of the clientele, so it would be yeah. pressure on the insurance.
Right, and the larger the pool, the cheaper the rates, because you're spreading yeah. that obligation out over a lot of people, which is why I think it's very compelling for California, given the number of people who are here and could be a part of that insurance pool.
Well, if all goes well, how long do you think it will be before this would reach the governor's desk?
We just started a two-year session, and bills typically have a one-year life, which means that I'm trying to get all my bills to the governor's desk by middle of September of next year. But bills like the bottle cap bill that I have is now what we call a two-year bill. We're going to have a little longer conversation around it, and it will probably not come up in committee until next January. And so the single payer bill could either be moved through very quickly and be on the governor's desk by early fall, or if the conversation needs to be a little bit longer, which wouldn't surprise me, but we'll see, then it could be something where we're putting on his desk next February.
Well, that's not
yeah,
too far
not too
away.
Far away.
That really isn't.
Yeah. And sometimes having a two-year bill, although I'm frustrated with the bottle cap bill, but sometimes it's not a bad opportunity to have a little more in-depth conversations throughout the summer and the fall when we're not in session, and we can get a lot of work done in that time.
Yeah, I bet you can.
Yeah.
So for those people who would like to see this happen, is there anything that they can do to set a fire under this?
Well, call your legislators and make sure that we're continuing to push it through. It's one of the reasons that I'm a co-author of this bill. It's something that I believe in, but it's also, by co-authoring it, a signal to my constituents of my interest in it. And so they're welcome to contact me. And then also, if anybody knows or has connections in other parts of the state, getting them to contact their legislators and saying, hey, we're very interested in this, so that the more votes we get, the better off we are, obviously. I mean, there are minimal thresholds that we'll need to get it passed in the first place, but I would hope that we can put together such a compelling package that we'd have the strength of the legislature behind it.
Is there any particular obstacle you face in doing this?
Right now, the biggest question is how we structure it and what it's going to cost the state. That's the biggest obstacle. And the insurance companies, a lot of the medical providers right now are pushing back. They're still trying to absorb the Affordable Care Act, and they're telling us this is a little bit too much. But I think it's very timely to have this conversation.
Yeah, I can see why you would. So now let's talk about something a little closer to home, San Lorenzo River.
San Lorenzo River.
Yeah, now that, you know, that flooded this year, as I'm sure you're aware.
Yeah.
And you have a bill that would try to help get the work done that would keep it from flooding. Can you talk a little bit about that?
Yeah, it's more of an administrative bill. Poor city of Santa Cruz. City of Santa Cruz has been working for years and has allocations from the state and had allocations from the feds through the Corps of Engineers. And the Corps of Engineers backed out, and they're saying they're not going to participate. So about 25% of what it would cost to actually do the flood control is no longer on the table. The way that the state grants are structured is it requires that federal part in order for their permission. So the city was given the state allocation on the promise that they were going to get money from the feds. Well, the feds, State Corps of Engineers, has now backed out. The city has figured out how to raise money. They've got the money of their own to be able to put on the table, but because of that state requirement, they can't. They still need that federal money. So what my bill does is say, yeah, you have your own money, you've got the state's money, go ahead. You don't need to have the Corps of Engineers. And that's what the bill does.
Well, so will that, when do you think that will be, it's in appropriations, is that right?
It's in appropriations, and it was on a committee agenda. Unfortunately, it got pulled off of the consent agenda. It had been on the consent agenda because it's really that simple of a concept. But there was some concerns raised by some of my Republican colleagues who I think didn't understand it. They actually thought that if they could kill this, then that would be state money that wouldn't have to go to the city. But that's not really the case. It's the city wanting to spend its own money and the Corps kind of backing out. So I answered those questions, which ultimately were a little silly, but I answered those questions in the Appropriations Committee. And because there's money involved, they're deciding on it. And I hope to get it to the floor fairly soon and be able to make that case on the floor of the Assembly and move it over to the Senate. So it's not that tough of a question. I'm fairly confident. Although I hate to say that now because who knows what can go wrong. But I'm fairly confident to get it over the Senate and be able to get it on the governor's desk. And because it's not costing the state any money, it should be a pretty simple ask.
And it does happen all the time that river overflows every time we have a drought and then rain.
Oh yeah. And in the cycle, if we can get it to the governor's desk this summer or this fall, it would take effect January 1. And so next January, the city could start to move ahead on that authority. Yeah.
That sounds great. So tell me what's next for you. What's your pressing objective?
I went to the legislature to work in really three areas. The environment, which I have several environmental bills, and I'm co-chair of the Legislative Environmental Caucus, and I am chair of a select committee on coastal protection. So I have my fingers in a number of different significant environmental conversations. I also do a lot of child welfare and a lot of prison reform, especially around juvenile justice. And I've got bills on juvenile competency this year, record sealing, really trying to make the system work better for the youth who are in the system. On the child welfare side, I ran a bill 2 years ago that was probably the most significant change to how the services we provide to foster youth that's come across the state in 20 plus years. And it's a complicated bill. It's a complicated systems change. So I ran a cleanup bill last year, which was actually more than just cleanup, that we added mental health services for the first time up front in that child's experience when they get pulled out of a family, which is a significant change to the way the state does business. This year I'm doing more implementation. I'll probably do a bill on this every single year. And as we learn about how this program is implemented, as we learn of challenges, that dynamic process of being able to revisit it every year, we can fix problems and issues as they come up, rather than waiting for a decade before we address it again. So it's a dynamic process. We're working very closely with the State Department of Social Services. We're working very closely with the counties who implement the program and all of the stakeholders who are the ones in our communities who care for these children. So it's a lot of work, but it's kind of exciting to be able to have that level of change, all to improve outcomes for kids.
Oh yeah, and they're the next generation. You can't.
They're the next generation. Yeah, and the better we can take care of this population, the better we can take care of all kids.
So true. Well, I have one more quick question for you. You had a very interesting bill about secrecy, about lawsuits kind of being closed off, and people can't find, people are not aware of a terrible danger in their area because it gets sealed. Can you tell us a little about that?
Yeah, that's actually a very important bill. The way that it often works, if there's somebody is injured by a product, and this is with faulty seatbacks in cars, gun triggers, tires, that when somebody's injured or is killed, there'll be a lawsuit. And what the manufacturers often do is say, all right, I will settle with you, but you now have to keep the settlement a secret. You can't talk any more about the case. And so there's a public danger that's out there that persists for 10, 15 years. And what this bill would do would be in cases of death or significant bodily harm, and in a case where that harm is likely to be repeated, that you can't have a secret settlement. The public has the right to know of the danger, and the company can no longer hide behind those secret settlements and not be forced to fix the danger.
Well, Assemblyman Scott, or Assembly Member, should I say, Mark Stone, we thank you so much for all the work you're doing to make us all safer.
Thank you.
And we hope you come back again.
Thank you. I'd be happy to.
We hope you've enjoyed this elected spotlight as well. Be sure to join us in June when we'll talk with First District Supervisor John Leopold. If you have questions you'd like to ask Supervisor Leopold, send them to me at bkingreed@communitytv.org. Thank you and good night. This was great. Thank you for taking the time to.